Sometimes in political debate, the facts get in the way, and that is precisely the problem my next guest is hoping to address. Dr. Peter Frumhoff is the Director of Science and Policy at the Union of Concerned Scientists. Dr. Frumhoff is here to explain the new initiative, which launches here today in San Diego. Thank you for being here.
My pleasure, Joy.
So who are these concerned scientists, and what are you concerned about?
So the Union of Concerned Scientists is an organization that was founded some 40 years ago by a group of originally physicists concerned about the misuse of funding that was only going for physics research in the defense community. This was during the Vietnam War, and expanded to really look for ways for scientists across the spectrum of expertise. I'm a biologist, to put their voices into making sure science is heard in policy debates ranging from climate change to energy to sustainable agriculture to nuclear power to nuclear safety to military issues. And we're deeply involved in a range of science policy debates, and we're concerned today with building a Center for Science and Democracy, which is really about restoring that kind of pragmatic, evidence-based dialogue where facts really matter, where people are maybe entitled to their own opinions, but not entitled to their own facts on a range of issues. And that's what we're doing here today at the Scripps Institute of Oceanography.
We see this, don't we, with climate change as one example, where we sort of have these emotional arguments and we lose sight of what the facts say, don't we?
We do. In fact, just yesterday, the good state of North Carolina, the Senate in the state of North Carolina, passed a bill telling all of the coastal counties of that state to ignore the science of sea level rise. Sea level rise is projected to increase by about a foot, by about 3 feet this century in coastal planning, that they really don't want the science of climate change, of sea level rise, to be part of the decision-making apparatus in the state. And despite what their science advisors are telling them, despite what the National Academy of Sciences is telling them, and that's just no way to run a government, in my view. And that kind of rejection of good science is dangerous, and we should really be moving back to a place where we can vigorously debate what to do about an issue, whether it be climate change or nuclear safety or any issue that confronts us today that has a science component. But we should really start with the facts.
You say moving back, so it wasn't always this way, and what changed so that now we are losing sight of science?
Well, we have a long history and tradition in this country of rational debate. Our founders were not just Benjamin Franklin, kind of the archetype of the of our founder scientists, cared deeply about science and openness and respect for facts. Abraham Lincoln founded the National Academy of Sciences in the middle of the Civil War to help ensure that our government had good science to inform our decision making. President Nixon put into act the Clean Air Act, which was a science-based piece of legislation to control pollutants and protect public health. We've had a long history of bipartisan kind of pragmatic decision-making about issues that affect us, and that's really been lost today. We've got a very partisan political climate. There's been a disappearing middle in American politics, and people, certainly in government in many places, do feel like they're entitled to their own facts. And the goal of the center is to really reawaken a public dialogue about the values of science and the values of our democracy and what we believe is kind of a dormant pragmatism that can overcome, if we're successful, the kind of partisan rancor that leads people to reject information, even as we may need to debate over what to do about a problem.
Should we blame the media a little bit? Science can be complicated, and sometimes the truth is complicated, and if it doesn't fit into a 15-second soundbite, then basically you don't get heard. How does the media play a role in this?
Well, we've certainly seen a decline in good science journalism in the media. A lot of people who've been writing about science in the print media have lost their jobs, but we've also had a diversification of the media. So there's a broad range of places where people can get their sources of information, or in many cases misinformation. In the digital media, people can go to and tend to go to places that reinforce their values, mm-hmm. right? And so, whether it's MSNBC or Fox News or public television, it's hard for folks to distinguish facts from what Stephen Colbert calls truthiness, right? To really know what the basic facts are, and so it is a challenge. The media does have a responsibility, but I would say that scientists also have a responsibility to get out of our labs, to be more outspoken with the public, to engage in public conversation about what we know, and to listen to the public and really understand what concerns are, so that we can have more of a two-way dialogue than we've had to date.
We are out of time, but we have a lot more information about your initiative on our website, kpbs.org, a number of links people can find out more about it. Thank you, Doctor, for being here.
My pleasure.